heard about reactive frameworks? Who didn't hear about reactive? Everybody tells us to be proactive. You need to start a new thing, innovating thing. But in systems, it's very useful to be reactive. Means don't make the system busy unless you are doing something. So just don't even wait. Don't do thread sleep. Just leave the system, CPU, and other resources, memory alone, and just wait until I call you. Reactive systems should be responsive. And responsive means fast, rapid response, and use less than 2 seconds, as you most know. Resilient, which you all probably know this also, and elastic. And for all these three attributes, three properties, you must be message-driven. Message-driven means you talk between the executables that you use inside JVM or inside your process. You talk using messages. You don't invoke methods, but you do it over async method. So you don't block, you are really non-blocking in IO, in networking. And this is really the enablement of being responsive, resilient, and elastic. So main thing about reactive systems is using message bus. Message bus, which is not what we all know, active MQ or other queuing systems. It's very lightweight, most of the time internal in the process. It's not another process that you start, another message broker that you need to connect to TCP, but it's internal event loop, as you all probably heard about, Node.js. So Vert.x is the Java Node.js. But note that it's only non-blocking system that gives you APIs, which are to read the file system with non-blocking, like NIO, or using NETI for networking. It's also giving you the entire ecosystem to develop simple ACA-like framework, simple observer design pattern that you can ask to one and then get callback. And it is the advantage on top of Node.js is that you can use the entire CPUs, all the CPUs on the system. Node.js will use, it's single-threaded, it will use only single CPU. Or maybe I'm wrong, somebody's saying that I'm wrong. Okay, so I might be wrong. That's what I know about Node.js, I'm not expert there. But this will create, if you have four CPUs, will create four event loops that will work in parallel and they will handle all the events. So I'm from Hewlett Packard Enterprise. That's what we told to be the new name of HP software, used to be Mercury. And I'm architect there. I'm working in research and innovation of application performance management solutions. Currently, the new solution is AppPulse. It's a cloud-based solution for application performance monitoring. And there I developed one Vert.x application, which is, we will see it in a minute. So a little bit background about Vert.x. As you see here, Jax, same time as Hazelcast, 2014 winner. And it started by Tim Fox at 2011, and he started as a developer in Red Hat, developing the JBoss Hornet queue. And he started the Vert.x in Red Hat, then moved to Spring Source, and later on came back to Red Hat, who took this project. And now it's an Eclipse Foundation open source. Again, Apache 2 license, so you can all get it and use it. That's already said. And in latest release is actually a month ago. In October, it's 3.1. Got lots of major changes using Java 8 lambdas and a lot of utilities compared to the 2.1, the previous release, which was a little bit not so easy to use. And they got a lot of new non-blocking APIs. On top of JDBC, for example. JDBC is a blocking API, which probably you all used, and like in every monolithic application, and you use Tomcat, which is servlet APIs. It's also blocking API. Then you use another blocking API, JDBC. So you running, you're getting a request, and you just run line by line and wait until the IO gets back. And this can be very, very slow when you have lots of requests. For example, when you have some agent send you lots of events from mobile phones, monitoring mobile phones, monitoring lots of IoT, for example. So you have many, many requests in a second. And what we used to call well-performed application that could handle 1,000 EPS, it's very, very slow in this big data world. So Vert.x 3.1 introduced also MongoDB client, and a lot of Redis, and a lot of new APIs, very easy to use. And let's see some, we will see some examples in a minute. Reactive frameworks, there are many. Probably you all know Akka, and Reactive X, which has a lot of wrapping for Scala, for Java, for Ruby, and other implementation of reactive frameworks. Java is actually integrated with Vert.x. You can use Rx for Java inside Vert.x and use the observable object, and really, if you use to Rx Java, it's makes it easy to write in Vert.x also. The polyglot is one major thing, but I'm not sure how many teams are using different languages developing. Do you use different languages in your development instead of JavaScript, web application, and at the backend is a single language? They were in version 2. They were supporting Scala also, and Clojure, and other JVM languages, but currently they got focused, and they have only these four languages. Maybe they will add more to the version 3 in the future. So these three languages make it very easy to use Vert.x in your team. Depends on your what's your team know how to develop, what language they know, and the most fitting language to what the application is doing. So I was using Java because I'm Java developer, I was actually implementing in my application around 8 or 9 verticals, which each vertical is a single class. It's a like executable or actor. And this is the main building block of Vert.x. So if you use Vert.x, you probably start by extending abstract vertical. Then you have some guarantee that all these callbacks would come to the same event loop. So you don't switch between threads. So it's like single thread. You don't need to care about multi-threading. You are just using the non-blocking APIs, and you will get the callbacks on the same thread. You can have, if you have a vertical, you can configure how many instances of these verticals you want to use. And if you're using, let's say, Tomcat, and you want to add Vert.x inside, it's possible. It's not a framework. It's not a like application server. It is a library that you can just inject, import Maven jar, and use it. You will get everything, the event bus inside. You will get the capability of the non-blocking APIs. And I was just implementing, I took one web application, Tomcat, and I was extending it with Vert.x to remove the blocking of the request, to just open the bottleneck at the beginning of the servlet and let all the flow, and after I verify the input, I can run everything async without having a messaging queue, without using JMS in the middle. I'm just putting Vert.x in the middle and sending events. You can embed Vert.x inside your code. You just have a factory method, and you get a Vert.x instance, and you can really flow from there to and embed it in any project. So it's as simple as that. When you configure how many instances you want to have, the how many instances of a certain vertical, you will get it load balanced. So if you have lots of event going to a vertical, it will do one rubin between all the verticals. So if you have a blocking API vertical, you need to call JDBC without the async JDBC client. So you can define the vertical as a worker vertical. It means it will get its own thread, and it will execute in async way in another thread from thread pool, and you will get notified when it's finished. So you can really use it in every application that you want to inject async I/O. Okay, so just I mentioned there is a messaging bus. It's an internal messaging bus. You just can do point-to-point, send and receive, and you can do publish, subscribe. So you can do broadcasting to a dashboard. And the messaging bus is actually getting from the server until you can get it in your JavaScript web app. You can then get the message in the JavaScript web app. You publish to a queue, and on the JavaScript, you will get the message. So it's very easy to implement a dashboard. We will see the JavaScript, very short, create server, and then listen, and then I can just run it. This is the actual code, just listening to port 8080, the well-known port. And this is the JavaScript file, and I'm just on this directory, and I can just run Vert.x. This is, you can run it actually not from command line. You can run it as a package. If it's a JavaScript, if it's Java, you can run it just Java minus jar if you packed it as a jar. So I just tried Netty to use for HTTP client. And I needed to write like three classes in order to invoke some HTTP. And here it's like few lines and you can get the server, and it's one line and you can send HTTP call, async. It's very, very simplified API for non-blocking. Under the hood, it's all running Netty and Hazelcast. If you want to have shared data map, it is using Hazelcast to let you save hash maps, concurrent hash map, of course, around the cluster. Or it can be even local shared data that it's not around the cluster, it's just on your JVM, but you want to get to the data from different verticals, from different execution points, so you can have this shared data very easy. Another example I want to show is this class, which is actually Java class. And it's very nice, cool example, because you can run this Java class without even compiling it. So you can just run Vert.x server, and it will do compilation on the fly, and will hopefully, with this responsive computer, will okay. Less than the JavaScript, it's 2 seconds only. So it is now, we can see here, it's a different example, which is, you cannot see, happily served by some process ID, because this example, I didn't run it as high availability, but there is a very simple way to run Hazelcast cluster with Hazelcast cluster manager, which is the default cluster manager. Even though if you want to implement different cluster manager or to use different cluster manager, it's pluggable. You can just configure it via the configuration file and change the cluster manager. But if I run it with minus HA, you can see your already known output of Hazelcast. Should you probably remember, but it's a little bit slow. Let's see how the high availability is working. I can really run another CMD and just run Vert.x bare instance, which is another instance of Vert.x that will connect to a cluster, which is the local cluster. And once I will kill the original process, this Vert.x, which is not having the vertical of the server running now, it will just take over and run the so now it's really deployed, and you can see that this instance is 6568, and now I will go and search for this process. 1 minute, here. So this process on the task manager and just kill it. If I will not kill it, it will not go to the bare instance. It will not do the recover. Because if I will kill it gracefully, it will just say, okay, you meant to kill it, so nothing really to do. Let's see, six, too many processes, 6.5. Okay, this is the Java. And just let's kill it. And the output, you can see that here it was killed, and here it is just getting a message from the other node that it took over this server Java, which must be, of course, on the class path, which it is running, because it's on the same directory, and it's on the class path, and it's looking for it as a resource. And now if I will go and see, it's just this another Java process, 10.5.5.2, which is here, probably you can. So this is very simple example of high availability in Vert.x. Let's go back to here. So we saw how we can create server very, very, very fast, small code. And now let's see a little bit. I mentioned already the event bus, point to point, send, and consume. And you can do really publish. And what's nice about it is that you can really send reply, and then another reply, and then another reply, and you can really ping pong between your verticals. So it is your design how you want to send messages, but you got all the flexibility. So you can really have a single point when you manage all the data flow, or you can do it from one vertical to another vertical, then to the other vertical, based on your rules. And you do you can do replies. So it's really, really nice. And what you can really send on this, the most recommended object to send over the bus is JSON, because it is can be shared between JavaScript and Java. So it's really the most useful. But you can even do your custom class and do the code and encode it. So we can send everything on the bus. It must be small because you don't want to send big objects. What else? So all the utilities. You have the core jars of Vert.x. It includes the HTTP client and server and everything, but it doesn't include a lot of utilities when you use the web jars, the web project. So Vert.x is three something, include a lot of libraries. So if you want to have all the facilities like sessions, authorization, cookies, and multi-parts, HTTP. I'm talking about HTTP because most of the time we are having web applications. But there are lots of other utilities coming not in the core libraries. So you just select what you want. If you need a Redis, so you can take the Redis client. Lot of different libraries, and they added authorization, security, auth2 implementations of the security, the Shiro, Apache Shiro, and the integration with Rx Java. So really. Version 3.1 is entire environment similar. Probably it's something reminding Spring framework, which has everything inside, but it's not so rich, and it's usually combined open source. It's not written from scratch, but it makes it very simple API. So this is an example of an API when you want to have a REST application. Hope you can see this. But this is an example from my code, but here you can see it's a parameter that you get in REST. You just get parameter with this name. So you declare here. You can see it's Java 8. So you can see lambdas here. Here is the important part. So this is a REST API example. Very easy to write all the method calls you see here. It's another lambdas. So it's very clear. Unlike the previous version, when you need to have some anonymous class which implements that, and oh, it was a lot of code. Now it's Scala-like. JDBC code, Scala left us. Okay. JDBC code, it's also, again, it's a long code, but you can understand the async callbacks. You just get connection. You don't need to wait. The line pass, and the client is free, can do something else. Only when the connection is back, you get to this lambda inside. So everything is working very fast in terms of the end user. But it can be internally blocked if it is working very slow, if the connection is slow. So you will get a lot of waiting on the queues to run. All these lambdas inside, you will see, for example, if this is select, so let's talk about inserts. So you can see that the data is getting into the database after some delay, because everything you sent a lot of requests to insert, but it's just inserting after 2 minutes. But it's okay because the client is not blocked and he can keep sending. Yes, questions?
Yeah, I have a question. It's a non-blocking operation with this code. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Where are you waiting somewhere, or do you return the result without the information that you need for the request?
No, I can return the response inside the callback.
Yeah,
because I'm getting the same pointer to the response, to the response object. So it will not block the thread, the user will not get response, the user will wait. If it's an HTTP call, for example, so the user will still wait until the callback is called and you send response end, and you end the response.
That's what I'm asking. If you have, for example, if you apply this code from a server, mm-hmm. okay, and you bypass this line of code, then when you get to the end of the get method of the server, you're supposed to return a response to the user.
Mm-hmm.
So in this place, you are actually applying your wait.
You can do this. There is a Vert.x sync that you can apply wait for without blocking the event loop, or without really blocking the thread, because it's using futures. So it's someone is parking somewhere and waiting to be notified by the system, by the probably. I'm not sure how it works under the hood, but I guess that the operating system is notifying the JVM that I got back from reading the file, or I got back from the connection. So it will not block the Java thread. But the user, the end user, until he gets response, the end of the response, he will wait. But you can get on that time, lots of different requests. So your application server is free. You can get lots of different requests, but user, if the callback is slow, nobody can help you. Yes?
The code that you showed us now, mm-hmm. is the Java 8 syntax.
Yeah.
I'm really blown away by it, because it's
Scala syntax.
Almost like Java.
Almost, yeah.
But a lot of us developers in Java are sometimes, I don't know, lazy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You don't don't like passing a lot of
new syntax and stuff.
And the method parameters rely a lot on fields in the class state. And my question is whether there is a mechanism to allow keeping some of that code, even if I go to over to the Vert.x style, maybe using some,
You mean we used the code?
Memory construct or something like that to allow passing state, not just through parameters on the stack.
So you mean if the question is whether you can use here like members, and use this inside the callback?
I'm pretty sure not, because
yes, you can. you can use members, class members in the callback, but if you have something that is not final in the beginning of the method, you cannot use it inside. But if you define it as final, it means the pointer is not going to change. You can use it inside the callback. Okay. But
I guess you mean together with distributed operations. So if you have multiple Vert.x instances, right? Because then you have to share the state of a class.
I
If it is a lot of instances of this vertical, because its default is single instance you get. But if you deploy like 10 instances of this, and you have a map, member map, or array that is mutating, which is not recommended, having mutating member in Vert.x, you can just use it in the local shared data. So you can have it from the local shared, which is thread safe, because it's concurrent arrays and the concurrent hash maps. So this is a safe way if you have a lot of instances of this vertical. But if you decide I need single instance, so we don't need to care about multi-thread. It's only single instance. Yeah. Yes, it's part of the design of reactive systems. So they support back pressure. If you have like stress load on the system, you will probably get timeout and they will try to recover from it. So it will send again. It's also a thing that makes it difficult to debug. So they have this back pressure mechanism on the event bus. So when you send messages and something fails in the middle, so it can resend it. I'm not sure if it's how configurable it is, but there is something. Yeah, I know that they have it on the design. It's probably implemented. I really didn't get into it, but I read about this capability of Vert.x to tell everybody, okay, stop working now. I'm too stressed. Don't send me data. So this is mechanism of the verticals and. You can have you can define the number of instances and set maximum instances and minimum instances so it can be flexible, so it can start new instances when it's needed. So this is another capability. When you deploy a vertical, Actually, I didn't show it here, but usually when you develop an application, you have several verticals, several executables. So you have a main executable, which is deploying everything. And it's deploying with some kind of configuration. So you define, I want to have 5 instances of vertical A, and then because I have only 5 connections to this server, I want between 1 to 5. And you can deploy it. In the main vertical, you really decide how you want to deploy the rest of the verticals based on some configuration or based on your intelligence. I mean, intelligence of the system. So it knows how many cores I have, so I want to do it different. So the deployment of a vertical has lots of options, and you can use it to optimize the workload. Some new features on Vert.x 3.1, they have lots of new things, but things that I wanted to mention is just having a capability, if you don't like to write it in the manner of lots of callbacks, and don't like this Node.js callbacks syntax, and you can do it like a sync, but without blocking the kernel. So it means you just call some method and wait. This is the project I did, and it's just doing crawling Google Play and the Apple Store for comments, running some computation, sentiment analysis, classification, and each computation is vertical, and it's doing it very, very fluent. And I really implemented it quite fast with very little code. It's just crawling the web, analyzing, persisted the analysis, and retrieving reports. Everything is asynchronously. And let's do the demo. So we saw the high availability server. Not this one. And we can see some different examples. There are many examples on the, and we can see the sharing server. Sharing server is actually same server. It's always in use because I didn't kill this one. So let's kill it. So port 8080 will be free. Here you can see just a simple server that is sending some response, and there is the actual deployment, which is this one. It is setting 2 instances of this vertical. When deploy vertical, just give the class name. You can give it and have it compiled. You can really build everything as a fat jar. It means we'll take all the classes, put in single jar, and you can just run it with Java minus jar. You will configure the main class, and it is very easy to move between nodes and without any dependencies, just run Java. Here you can see that the deployment, you can run it from the IDE. Really, I remember my times when I was trying to run something on JBoss, on the IDE. I had to have JBoss installed somewhere and some plugin and a lot of different things until it worked. So the sharing server, we just will run 2 instances of the server. And if I run the client, it will always call this server, and we will see that it is just doing ground loop in between the instances. So this is the actually the client HTTP. There is get now, which is doing it and wait. So it is synchronic call, but you can do just get, and it's not synchronic call, but it's will not be able to write more payload. You cannot write data on this request. If you want to do get and then write some parameters afterwards, you will not do get now. And here you just get a response. You see, like in this lambda is very short code when using it like that, and it will just print out. If I run the client, and you will be able to see the output, hopefully. So it will use each time different instance. When you it's doing just like a load balancer for you. And that's it. So I want to thank you and wish you a good night.